verses 1 to 3, and we're going to read into chapter 3, in verse 6. Just to give you some more. Chapter 2, verse 23, and all the way through chapter 3, verse 6. We're looking at two different stories here, but with the same general thesis. So let's begin with verse 23. So then it came to pass that he went to the court of Jesus on the Sabbath day. And his disciples became as they went to put the ears of corn. And the Pharisees said unto him, Behold, why do they on the Sabbath day? Why do they on the Sabbath day that which is not lawful? And he said unto them, Have you never read what David did when he had need and was hungry? He did the day that we with him. How he went into the house of God and received him on the side of priests. Thy priest, and his chief and children, which is not lawful to eat, but for the priest, and gave also to them which were with him. And he said unto them, The Sabbath was made for man, and not made for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. Verse 1 of chapter 3. And he said unto them, This synagogue, and there was a man there which had a withered hand. And they watched him, whether he were still home on the Sabbath day, that they might accuse him. And he saith unto the man, which hath the withered hand, stand forth. And he saith unto them, Is it lawful to be good on the Sabbath day, or to do evil, to save life, or to kill? To be held in peace. And when he had looked round about on them that was coming down, he was grieved for the hardness of their heart. He stretched forth his hand, and he stretched it out, and his hand was restored whole as the other. And the Pharisees went forth, and straightway put counsel with the authorities against him, how they might be destroyed. But God's word is one thing, the word is the All the things of this passage, Lord, there is truth here, and the truth here that we need. Lord, there are warnings here for us to protect. Lord, help us to keep these warnings. Lord, help us to preach your word. Help us to speak about your word. To glean the truth from each other. I have this to your son's name. I titled this lesson, The Sermon Tonight, In Need of an Alignment. In Need of an Alignment. Recently, this being said to me, I think my heart is starting to pull to the left more and more. And so the next time I go, I notice, you know, it's really starting to pull to the right. You really, the whole time you're driving, you've got to hold the wheel because the car wants to pull to the right. So I take it to, I don't know, like, some part of what I want to stop right there. And they do the line, and I've got the car which is a little bit like, it's still pulling to the right. And so I went back to the point, and I'm like, no, you know, I might be doing it, it's still pulling to the right. So, they worked on it again, and I got the car, and they said, Oh, it's ready, you're good to go, and I got the car, and I drove away. So, Paul was thinking, right? So, the car is still going to drive right now. Hopefully, it's the first time I'm going to leave this car, and it will get fixed within hours, but I just got the car, and it's like, when I was thinking about that, I was thinking about this, and I started thinking about how a vehicle is a very small environment. Something very small, very small, because I can't find it to fix it. A very small amount makes a big difference. And the vehicle can begin to wander and veer off to the side. And I believe that as Christians, you and I, we can become the balance in our lives, in our Christian walks, and in our hearts. And if we do not get rid of God, we are in danger of wanting to begin to vary. Places. My pastor from Tom Jones and Pastor Jones, I was here to tell you, he often said that so many areas of life have ditches on both sides. And as Christians, we need to be biblical and biblically balanced. Because if we go too far to the left, there's a ditch. And if we go too far to the right, there's a ditch. And it is very much what we are talking about tonight is one ditch that we need to avoid. So that we're talking about this topic. Legalism. If we Before we get to the part, I have to take some time to even talk about this word. Because this is one of those words that people hear very differently. There's a lot of disagreement about what this word means. And I'd like to spend a lot of time on this, but I won't. So here's what I want to give you. I want to give you what I think it is. It's biblical, a couple definitions of legalism. So here we go. I'm going to give you two definitions. I made this up. These are my definitions. First one, legalism is an disproportionate focus on external obedience for the purpose of earning salvation or justice. Legalism is a disproportionate focus on external obedience for the purpose of earning salvation or justice. Here's a little bit further definition. Legalism is an improper focus on external beliefs that gives the impression that obedience earns salvation or God's love. So I hope with those two definitions you're getting the idea of what I'm talking about today. I'm talking about wisdom. It's so focused on external obedience that we begin to feel that is how we are right with God is through obedience. And that's what we're going to see in tonight's passage, is that the Pharisees were focused so much on God's law that they had gone into a gift of legalism. Now, many people in the Christian world, especially today, they have reacted to the gift of legalism, and just like somebody in a vehicle can overcorrect, they start to feel one way, and they get scared, so they overcorrect. Many people in the Christian world have overcorrected the other gift, which is called license. And what that means is there are Christians that say, as long as you're saved, all that matters is your heart. What you do and how you dress and what you say, not that really matters. All we have to focus on is the heart. Four reasons we must avoid legalism. The first one tonight, we're going to see verses 23 and 22, it actually ignores the spirit of the law. It ignores the spirit of the law. So look with me at verse 23. So it came to pass that as he went through the cornfield on the Sabbath day, and his disciples began as they went to pluck the ears of corn. And the Pharisees said unto him, Behold, why do they on the Sabbath day that which is not lawful? And he said unto them, Have you ever read what David did when he had meat and was a hunger? Seeing they that were with him, how they went into the house of the God in the days of the house of the high priest, and he beat the children which is not lawful to eat, but for the priest, and gave also to them which were with him. And he said unto them, The Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. We can just talk about this until the last couple of weeks back. What's happening here? Jesus, remember, Jesus has a traveling ministry. He's going to tell this one. And by Jewish law, they were not to take the grave on the Sabbath, which is Saturday, which is time. They're not to take the grave, but they're traveling. And he doesn't give a lot to teach them. But whatever it is, the disciples decided, I'm hungry, we're walking, here's a cornfield, a grain field. Let's do so. So they decided to travel, which, by the way, this was not illegal from a legal standpoint. In that day, travelers could speak out of the fields as they traveled. Proper about just for that work field, this was not a legality issue there. The issue was that it was the Sabbath. And the Pharisees, I don't know if you would just start to be like me, be like, this is the Pharisees, but it's a hard part of the disciples. Like, what are they doing? They're watching. Like, they just pop up out of the bushes. I don't know. It doesn't sound like, in my mind, that's weird that the Pharisees are even here. Okay? But the Pharisees come to Jesus and say, Why are you allowing this? Why are you allowing this? Because it's great. This is against the law. It's violating the Sabbath. And Jesus doesn't give them a great answer. He reminds them of this story. And the story was about David. Without going into too much detail, David installed a plan to kill David. And David's wife was on the mat for his wife. They had no breakfast, they had no food, and they're getting ready to go to the hospital. And David comes to the priest and says, You would have any weapons and have any food? And the priest says, All we have is this showbread. Now, the showbread was the ceremony, the wedding, the capital that are in the mat. The only the priest could eat it every Sabbath once they replaced it with the bread. And David, he loved God and he loved God's law, and he very much tried to follow the law. He recognized that this man needed this bread. What the king does there, when I get all the details, he chooses to take that bread for his man. And it seems in this passage that Jesus is saying, David made a right decision. Jesus, here's the question. I mean, we're talking about ethics here, like, when you're faced, if you're faced with a situation, let my man starve or violate the law and take this bread. Those are both options that we don't do. That's between a rock and a hard place. Yet here, Jesus commands them to call you a true what they do. So what is the point here? I believe what Jesus is trying to communicate to the Pharisees, I believe what he's trying to communicate, is that we, when we're considering God's word and God's law, that we need to think about the spirit of the law and not just the letter of the law. That there are situations where in an emergency, the best decision was for David to preserve his life and to preserve his man's life by taking that bread. And some people would say, No, he's sinning. Well, maybe if you feel that way, that's fine, but you're going to take it up with Jesus. Because Jesus does need to do the right thing. So there's a lot of ethical dilemmas here, but I believe this is what Jesus is communicating, is that there is a law is not just there. Look at him in verse 27. He says, He said unto them, The Sabbath was made for man, and not made for the Sabbath. What is he indicating there? There is a purpose what it's been paid for, and that God designed the Sabbath for a good reason. there is a purpose behind the law. And when we stop, we step back and think about what the purpose is of God's commandments. And God's law sometimes will help us to not be so focused on the flesh and the law. 2 Corinthians 3, 6 says, "Who also has made us able ministers of the New Testament, both of not of the letter, but of the Spirit, for the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life." If we're going to not be legalistic, we need to take time to think about the purpose behind what we're doing. The purpose behind what you're doing for God, what your charge is when you're reading God's word, why does God want you to do this or that? That is the Spirit of the Lord. I believe that's what David said here. David said, "I'm in a tough situation." But this law was not meant to withhold food from people who are starving. So I'm going to make this decision. Let me give you a modern scenario that maybe lets you think about the spirit of the law versus the law of God. This is pretty natural for this time of year. How many of you have been sitting right here on the side of the road? Right? So when I was in Vietnam, I talked to my pastor. I was getting a call from somebody who had been here. But somebody was hit here and wounded here. And the deer would be landing in a position that he would just kill alive. Now, legally, let's say that person that hit the deer is dead because no friend from a native animal pet, but with a wound to the deer. They didn't do anything wrong, they hit the deer, and they broke its leg, and it's sitting there, and it's bone. That's terrible to the deer. And both of them love it, and we really don't want to see animals suffer. That's not good. But legally, by the law, that person is not legally allowed to shoot that deer unless it's innocent, or he has a deer license. And he has permission to go on to the level of life. So there's a lot of legal reasons that if somebody hits a deer with a car that they cannot shoot that deer legally. It also allows that they cannot take to a call that you say, "What do I do?" And it would be hard because oftentimes, what can I do? I'm a law enforcement officer. So I would try to give them advice like this. I would say, by the letter of the law, are you not supposed to shoot that deer? You're supposed to wait for a police officer to come shoot it. But oftentimes they would call this back, an officer is an hour away, and the deer is sitting there suffering. Now, if that person takes on this donation and dispatches that suffering animal, it's not a violation of the spirit of the law. That is not what the money law is trying to prevent. Isn't it? That is 100% not the point of the law. Now, when the person says that, did he break the law? Yes, he did. Did he get a grant from some place to be found where he had to be built? He's got to make a decision in that moment. But, and I'm not trying to talk about what he should do or what he shouldn't do. I think it's pretty obvious. But I'm just using it as an illustration to say that there are situations in our life where the letter of the law says, let God have it, but the spirit of the law says something different. And I believe what we're seeing right here is Jesus talking about this, and Jesus allowing his disciples to eat and drink wine on the Sabbath is exactly the same. We need to think about not just the letter of the law, but the spirit of the law. I believe that's what Jesus is trying to teach you. And let me remind you, legalism focuses on the letter of the law. It focuses on the external obedience to it. That focuses on the law. The important thing we need to remember is we need to think about the spirit of the law. Let's see the second thing we're going to see in verse 28. Our second chapter this evening. Legalism ignores the author of the law. Look at 3:27 and 28. It says, "And he said unto them, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath." I love what he's saying here. The word Lord right there in verse 28 is the same word that's in the chapter. So what he's really saying is this. Let me things to make great in verses 1 through 4 of chapter 3. The soul agrees that we must avoid legalism. It becomes excluded. Look at chapter 3 and say, and he rose again in the synagogue, and there was a man there which had a withered hand. And he washed him, whether he would heal him on the Sabbath day, that they might accuse him. And he said unto the man which had the withered hand, step forth. And he said unto them, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath day, or to do evil? To save life, or to kill? But to tell their secrets. Could you imagine the statement? These Pharisees are pretty bad. There's a man who has a chasm with his hand, who is suffering with his own thing. This is new thing to even just the life we don't want. But he has something he is struggling with. Say now that Jesus might heal him. And they care less about that man than they do if Jesus might heal someone. Don't you see, folks, when we get legalistic, when we get an unbiblical focus, an external opinion, it doesn't matter. Because we do not treat people like this. We begin to have to carry the culture to treat people for you. Were less concerned about the next hearing and more concerned about whether Jesus would violate their sanctity for the same. Did anybody find a verse in the Old Testament that says it's unlawful to heal somebody in the Sabbath? See, they might have gotten so far on it, and chapter 3 was an act of the law, and made their own standards. Because they were so important. Jesus says, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you pay tithes of mint and anise and thyme, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. These ought you to have done, and not to leave the oven open. You know what Jesus is saying? You Pharisees are so focused on external obedience that you are literally tithing out your senses to heaven. And yet, you are not doing law and judgment and mercy and faith. I love what he says there. Notice Jesus says, these ought you to have done, and not these are other untouched. Jesus said, it is good for you to tie those things out. That is nothing. There's nothing bad about that. But you're questioning about following the law and obeying God. That is great. But you shouldn't be so focused on trying to do things and yet mistreating and hurting people. You see how the course of the scripture that the Pharisees, they were using a loophole to neglect their own parents. It says that they were devouring widows' homes, meaning they were taking advantage of people for their widows. So they were singing in all these major ways, and yet they were focused on all these little areas of people. You see, folks, if we fall into the trap of legalism, we are going to hurt people. We're going to hurt people. Just like this man, sitting there suffering, who needs to be healed. And the Pharisees could not care less about his needs. They spoken of present people. They are trained. I heard a story one time from a pastor down south. He had been taking his vehicle to a mechanic shop, and he was witnessing to the owner of the shop. And he had a month-long ministry of trying to talk to the man, and the man said, no, the church isn't for me. The doctor never saved me. He had come after time trying to encourage this man to attend his church to get right with God. One Sunday, the man came in the store. It was a little bit earlier than the man was out of the parking lot to address the man. One of the deacons of the church walked out to that man and said, sir, we do not allow that in this place. You need to put that out right now, or you need to leave it. the pastor went into the mechanic's shop to get car work done. And he talked to the man about it, the truth. And the man said, "Well, I'll never talk to the truth." And he relayed the situation. The pastor pleaded with him and said, apologized and said that the guy had good intentions, but he didn't know what was right. And the man refused to hear him and never came back. When we get so focused, so focused, external acts of obedience, and we fail to care about people, we are creating this opportunities for the gospel are going to be lost. So this is to see God do a work in somebody's life, we are going to get out of it. I want to keep it to the present. Because that's where you're at. that's what we need to talk about.